You had a chance to meet David Wagner already. I met David Wagner a number of years ago through mutual friends. We met at Starbucks, believe it or not, and he has the audacity. I asked him, can I get you a Starbucks this morning? He says, no, I'll have a Dunkin' Donuts. He miles has said, I'm going to buy you a cat. So you don't like cats, do you? Okay, very good. So we met over coffee, and we've become friends ever since. And, before I had him come to our church, I'll make sure he's a man of integrity. And I will say this, Dave, and I say this very, very candidly, and also is the fact that he is a man of integrity. And, I know a lot of gifted people. I've met a lot of gifted people in the world. But you know what? I'm less impressed with giftedness, and I'm more impressed with humility and transparency. And David Wagner is those things. And I want to let you know, he's a very precious friend to our house and to me. And believe me, he's shown himself to have integrity. Where many others have fallen off, he stayed steady and strong. In fact, my wife and I, Sandra, for those of you who don't know, I'm the pastor of this church and haven't figured that out yet, if you're new here this morning. But we had two babies. First one was Luke, and we were excited about our first son. And then we prayed, and we felt it was time to have another child, and we had a miscarriage. And for any of you that's been through that, it's not an easy thing, especially when months go on, you start dreaming about it. And we had a miscarriage. And interesting enough, this is a little side note, but I feel like I need to share it this morning, is that my wife one time got up in the morning, and she said, I had a dream last night that we're supposed to name our child Dwell. Excuse me? Dwell? Like Noel? No, Dwell. D-W-E-L. I said, what kind of name is that? You know, I was thinking to myself, well, shortly thereafter, we lost the baby. And that name spoke to me, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High God. And so for some of you, you've been through that, and you know the pain. Then we had Hannah. What a blessing, our daughter. What a credit. We had a boy, we had the girl, and we're like, let's try again. And then we had another miscarriage. You're like, you know what? We got the boy, we got the girl. All we need to do is build a white picket fence, get a dog, no cat, and a goldfish. And we, you know, let's just forget about this. Too painful to try for children. And then David Wagner did something you're not supposed to do when you teach prophetic courses. And prophetic simply means hearing from God and sharing with other people. That's pretty much what it is. And the teacher never give names, never have people to get married, never say you're going to marry this person, and never give baby names. No, never say you have a baby. Well, he broke all protocol because he heard from the Lord. And he looked at me. I was sitting in the old building where the kids are right now. He said to Sandra and I, by this time next year, you're going to have a son. And something dropped in me. I'm like, I'm never having him back if he's wrong. But part of me said, that's a word from God. And so the Bible says faith without works is dead. So we made sure we did our works. And we did. Praise God for that. And as a result of that, she got pregnant. And, you know, sometimes when you're wondering, I don't feel a kick, what's going on, that word of the Lord, you're gonna have a son next year. And then they probably asked me, was it going to be a boy or a girl? And, of course, it was a boy. And so all through the gestation period, that word gave us extra confidence. And then, of course, Matthew was born. Matthew David Bucci, which is a gift from God. And my dad's name is David, and also to honor David as well. So you always will have a special place in our heart and our home because you heard from God and you do release that message. So would you please welcome back to Cornerstone Church, though he's been here already. He spoke in the first service, but just to welcome him back, would you please give him a warm welcome home to Pastor David?
Hallelujah. Well, it's good to be with you in the morning. And how I know he really loves me is he left the gifts for me. And so I appreciate that. And it's not empty either. That's really good. And I don't want to be tempted beyond anything I can resist. It was pretty funny. A couple of weeks ago, I was in a church that was fasting. And look at me. I'm... You should have me when you're feasting, not fasting, right? And so this church was fasting, and I wasn't. And so there were some people in the church, they were cheating too. And they made a nice Italian dinner for me. And at the end, you know, the pastor was there. He came for the end of the meal, and they had made this chocolate cake. How many know the Bible says, resist the devil and he'll flee? Well, I offered up resistance. I resisted that cake. I resisted that cake, and it didn't flee. So I reckoned it was gone, right? So that's how you know if something's from God or not. Just resist it. If it stays, it's the Lord. That's not biblical. It's just me. So good morning, Cornerstone. How are you? And what an amazing morning, and what an amazing God we serve. Amen? It's a beautiful time to be in New England and Connecticut. Just seeing the beauty of the Lord. I get to wear sweaters in weather like this because this is what I call winter. I live where you vacation. But truthfully, all Floridians, we miss the seasons. And so this is an amazing time of year to see the beauty of the Lord. I'm also from Chicago originally, so I am rejoicing. I am a Cub fan, and so I've waited my whole life for this moment. Now, I think that we could be getting really close to rapture. Because I don't know if it's true or not, but I felt like somebody told me there was a prophetic word once that Jesus told the Cubs, don't do anything until I get back. And so this could be the year. This could be the day. So if I were you, if you're looking for a sign, you need to get right with God today. All right? Miracles are happening all around. And so it's what a great privilege and honor just to be here. It's all right to have fun in church, isn't it? I say it like this, if you're not having fun in church, you're probably not doing church right. Because Jesus is the best thing going. Jesus is the best thing going. I don't know about you, but I was miserable and he came and changed the miserable into a miracle. He came and turned sorrow into joy. He came and turned everything around in my life. And come on, what we need right now in the world today is some joy. Amen? Come on, I believe that the enemy has been releasing false prophecies about agony, gloom, and despair. But aren't you glad that we have a God who's prophesying faith, hope, and love? And I would encourage you over the next 16 days, even just building up to the election and things. What if the people of God didn't give our own opinions about politicians and different things, but we actually spoke faith, hope, and love into the atmosphere? You know what I think? Things would change in Connecticut. You know what I think? Things would change in New England. Things would change in America. And so I believe this, that it's a time to really hear the voice of the Lord, to hear the voice of the Lord in this season. Because I know something. I know this to be true, that on November 9th, when you wake up, Jesus will still be on the throne. I don't know who will be in the White House, but Jesus will still be on the throne, right? He's going to be on the throne. He's going to be ruling and reigning. I don't think he's biting his fingers up there wondering, oh, what's going to happen? Is it Hillary or Trump? Right? If I were God, I'd just say, do over. Aren't you glad I'm not God, right? Come on. He's not on the throne wondering, what am I going to do? He's ruling and he's reigning. And the fact of the matter is that I believe as the people of God that we should be declaring life and speaking love. Are you hearing me? There's an assignment on this church to declare life and to speak love in this season like never before. We just close your eyes and lift your hands with me this morning. I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, you're about to feel the ripple effect of my glory. You're about to feel the ripple effects of your obedience. For I have marked this house with faithfulness. For I've called you to be a faithful people. But I've also called you to know and to walk in the faithfulness of God. And it is a season and a time like never before to hold fast your confession again to hope. For he who made the promise is faithful. And I felt like the Lord said that I'm moving this house into a season that will simply be called This Is That. This is that which was prophesied. It's going to be a season of the promises of God being kept to you corporately and personally, relationally, spiritually. And I saw the Lord just moving things out of the way. And I said, Lord, what are you doing? He said, the worship of this house is going to clear the air. And I feel like that there is a sound that God is about to release out of this place, not only in the sound of praise and worship, but also in the sound of the word that's going to clear the air. And I felt like the Lord said that this is a season of clarity in the midst of confusion in the earth, that I'm calling you to be a people of clarity, a people of surety. And I felt like the Lord said that this is a season of the sure thing, that this is the season where the hand of the Lord is about to move in power and might like never before. And I felt like the Spirit of the Lord said these words to me, that Cheshire shall be known as a city of salvation. This shall be known as a city of salvation. And I saw the salvation of the Lord coming in this place. He is the Lord who is mighty to save. He's not just able to save your soul, but he's able to save your body and your circumstance and your situation. And I feel the strong right hand of God in this room this morning. And I believe that today he's coming to heal. He's coming to heal bodies, but I also believe the Lord is the healer of our hope. And I feel like right now, even in this place, some of you are about to have your hope healed by the end of the morning. Some of you right now, that you're about to have your bodies healed and your hope healed. I believe right now that this is a season where everything is changing. I feel the winds of change in the atmosphere this morning. And I feel like the winds of change are directly connected to the winds of worship that are going to blow out of this place. And I heard the Lord say, as I walked into the building this morning, holy to the Lord, holy to the Lord, that this place is holy, it's set apart to the Lord. And I said, Lord, what makes it that way? And he said, consecration. And I feel like you're a consecrated people. Before Joshua was getting ready to cross the people into the promised land after 40 years in the wilderness, he got a word from the Lord that said, consecrate the people. Get them ready. Bring them together. Set them apart. They came together, and then he said, keep your eyes on the ark. Keep your eyes on the presence of God, because you've never been this way before. And I feel more than ever before, the Lord is saying to the people of Cornerstone, keep your eyes on the presence of God, because you have never been this way before. And so, Lord, I thank you right now for the new places and the new things that you're about to do in our midst today. Lord, I thank you right now. Last night, I was meeting with the leaders and Dream Team folks, and this is what I heard. It really scared me, and I didn't even say it last night. It scared me not in a natural way, but I felt the fear of the Lord on it. I kept hearing the Lord say, here they grow again. And I feel like it's a season of expansion. And listen, it's not about numbers, it's about names. But I feel like this church is about to double in size again, even over the course of the next 18 months. And I believe that the hand of the Lord is about to reach out of this place. And what I felt was that the Lord is making this house even like an epicenter of hope and healing for the region. And so, Lord, I thank you right now, Lord, for the families that are coming. Lord, I thank you right now for those of us that are even in the room. Lord, I thank you right now for family members getting saved and coming to the house of the Lord. Lord, I thank you for your word being fulfilled. And Lord, I thank you right now that, Lord, that this is the season that we're about to live in your dream like never before. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, that's a good word right there. How many know God's talking to you? Can I tell you something? You can hear a corporate word and just think that he's just talking to the church. And you'll miss the moment and you don't realize that he's actually talking to you. Because there's a corporate word that can become a personal word, and a personal word that becomes a corporate word. I believe that we're stepping into a season and a time of fulfillment. How many know that God is a keeper of his word? Numbers says that the Lord is not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that he would change his mind. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad he doesn't lie to you? And aren't you glad he doesn't take promises back? He does what he says. He's the God who actually does what he says. That's a powerful truth. The Bible also says that he watches over his word day and night, and he is careful to perform it. And I felt like this morning. The Lord said, I'm carefully watching over the word over your life. I'm carefully watching over the word over this house, and I'm careful to perform it. It means that he's paying attention to every detail. Can I tell you something? God's in the details. And he's going to take care of every detail of your life. This thing I know, that there is coming a day, according to Hebrews, which is also a direct quote out of Haggai, that says, afterwards I will shake the heavens and the earth so that the unshakable kingdom can remain. Here's what the prophetic does. It comes to shake everything in you that's not like Jesus, so that the unshakable thing can remain. There is a shaking taking place in the earth. Aren't you glad? God's about to shake everything off that's not like Jesus. He's about to shake things off of our political system. He's about to shake things off of the religious systems. He's about to shake some things off so that the unshakable kingdom can remain. How many know that's good news? I'm telling you right now, there's a shaking coming. And when the shaking comes, don't you fear like everybody else fears. Because God is not coming to create fear. 1 Timothy 1:7 says that God has not given us a spirit again to fear, but power and love and a sound mind. Come on, I feel the power, the love, and the sound mind of God in the room. Aren't you glad he's not reacting and responding? He's ruling and he's reigning. We're moving into a Habakkuk 1 verse 5 season. Look among the nations, be utterly astounded that even if it were told to you, you wouldn't be able to understand it. He's saying, I'm about to do so many amazing things. You can't count them all. You can't figure them out. And you can't make them. You won't be able to comprehend it. Aren't you glad he's a God without comprehension? Come on, there's bad news everywhere in there. Turn on the TV, bad news. Another scandal, another email, another this, another that. And it's very important in this season not to let bad news clog your filter. I said it to the dream team last night, that what you eat affects what you dream. What you eat affects what you dream. How many know it's true? Try eating pizza at 11 o'clock at night and going to sleep. You're going to have some dreams. It might not necessarily be God dreams, right? Here's what I'm talking about. I'm a guy who studies history and I love government stuff. And I found myself getting all emotional, all worked up, watching debates and then watching CNN and Fox News and MSNBC, and that was just a slip. And I don't know what I'm talking about. And I was just getting all worked up. And the Lord said, turn it off. Turn it off. Why are you listening to false prophecies? Why are you listening to things that don't speak life? Why are you listening to things that cause division and don't unite? Why are you listening to things? And he said, what you're eating is affecting your dream. It's changing your perspective. It's changing how you think. It's changing how you see. Come on, right now. I wonder if you'll just fast bad news for the next 16 days. And I wonder what would happen if we just began to speak and prophesy faith, hope, and love. Faith, hope, and love over the Democrats. Faith, hope, and love over the independents. Faith, hope, and love over the Republicans. Can I tell you something? God is neither Democrat nor Republican. He's righteous. And I'm telling you right now that the Lord is about to release a longing for righteousness in the earth. Here's what I believe. That the Lord is faithful, not only to us, but to our children and our children's children. And that I believe right now that the hand of the Lord is about to move. And there's about to be an outpouring on young people like never before. An outpouring on children like never before. That our sons and our daughters are actually going to prophesy to us. Come on, that's good news. Good news. How many know Jesus is good news? In Isaiah 61, and Jesus quotes it actually in Luke chapter 4. He's in the temple and they have him read from the scroll of Isaiah. And he said, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me. How many know the Spirit of the Lord is in you for you? The Holy Spirit is in me for me. He what does he do? He comforts me. He convicts me. He strengthens me. He encourages me. He speaks to me. He loves on me. The Spirit of the Lord is in me for me, but he's upon me for everybody else. You've got to know that. The Spirit of the Lord is in me for me, but he's upon me for a region. He's upon me for a nation. He's upon me for other people. The Spirit of the Lord is coming upon you like never before. Are you hearing me? The Spirit of the Lord, God, is upon me. He has anointed me. Can I tell you something? Anointing isn't just a little sign of the cross with oil on your forehead. When you got anointed, here's what it means. It means he pours out the whole jar of oil on you and rubs it into you so you can never get it out of your being. When I feel like God is coming to massage the oil of his anointing on the lives of every believer like never before. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to do what? To preach, proclaim, declare, release. Don't underestimate the power in your words. Don't underestimate that the miracle that people are looking for, even the miracle for you, may just be in your own mouth this morning. Come on, I believe there's a miracle in the house. Pastor Eric was talking to us last night about that. But I believe there's also a miracle in your mouth today. Come on, I believe right now that the Lord is challenging us to speak words of life, words of love, words that honor, words that reflect his heartbeat. Can I tell you something? I know this to be true. That God is madly in love with Bill and Hillary Clinton. And I know this to be true, that God is madly in love with Donald Trump. And I know this to be true, that I don't care if they are corrupt or they are perverted or they are all of those things. Here's what God sees in them. He longs for them to give their life to the Lord. Why? The Lord, his desire is that no man would perish, but everyone would come to the knowledge of the truth. And I wonder what would happen if the church would just start speaking salvation into the White House, salvation into the courthouse, salvation into the Congress, into the Senate, into the House of Representatives. I wonder what would happen if we would start preaching, declaring what God was saying, instead of getting caught up in the court of public opinion. See, you don't have to be prophetic to see what's wrong. But you do need to be prophetic to prophesy solutions. Can I tell you, the purpose of prophecy has never been about identifying what's wrong. The Father does not focus on what's wrong. He focuses on what's missing. Just let that sink in for a minute. Because I'm being more prophetic than what you realize this morning. I think this, I believe this, that often it's easy to see, right? It's easy to look at what's wrong in my finance, what's wrong in my marriage, what's wrong with my kids, what's wrong with my boss, what's wrong with the government, what's wrong with this. I wonder what would happen if we asked for God's eyes to see what's missing. Come on, ask the Lord right now. Lord, show me what's missing. What's missing? Show me the love that's missing. Show me the righteousness that's missing. Show me the peace that's missing. Come on, the kingdom of God is what? Righteousness and peace and joy. The kingdom of God is righteousness, it's peace, and it's joy. Those three things cannot be separated from the kingdom of God. Some of you right now, there's about to be an alignment. There's an adjustment taking place while I'm preaching this morning with righteousness, with peace, with joy. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach good news. How many know Jesus is good news? And the Christ in you is good news, right? Paul said, it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. I have this theory in my heart. It's the passion of my life that when the people see me coming and when they see you coming, they won't be able to say, here comes David Wagner and here comes Eric and here comes Pastor Tom and here comes this one and that one. But they would simply say, here comes hope and here comes glory. I wonder if we put him on display, what would happen? What's good news? What's good news? You have to understand the context of the day. How many know his disciples, Jesus' disciples, really didn't get who he was all the time? I think some of them were excited. They thought he was a revolutionary that was going to overthrow the evil Roman Empire. He had a different message for a different time. Things they never heard of before. And he said, I'm coming and I'm declaring the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to preach good news. And here's the context that they heard it in. Listen to me closely. In that day, when a king came and conquered another kingdom, his heralders, his men would go out. There would be a voice. There would be an ambassador. There would be a heralder that went before. And they would approach that kingdom. They would approach the gates of that city. And they would say, hear ye, I have good news for you. The king is coming. And here's what they heard. There's about to be a kingdom invasion. The good news is this. That's what they said in the world, and Jesus took it. God foresaw it and prophesied it. Here's what is saying. Can I tell you something? I've got a word for America. Good news is coming. There's about to be a kingdom invasion. That Jesus is still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come on. He is still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come on. Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he's about to invade Connecticut. He's about to invade Washington, D.C. He's about to invade our lives like never before. Come on, are you ready for a kingdom invasion? What's coming? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. It's a promise, but it's also my portion. Look at me. I don't leave the table till it's empty. I'm glad my mama raised me. You don't get up until your table is empty, until your plate is empty. Come on, there's a portion for you to feast on. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted. Come on, right now. It's an assignment on your life. David, I don't know what my calling is. Here's your calling. Bind up the brokenhearted. Go to the most broken people and get close to them. Why? That's where you'll find God. Psalm 118 says that he draws near to the brokenhearted. He draws near to the brokenhearted. Come on right now. Some of you need him to draw near to you this morning. The Lord sent me here to bind up the brokenhearted. But there's an anointing on your life to bind up the brokenhearted. Look around. I travel all around the world. So far this year, I've just looked at my miles this morning. I've flown 267,000 miles this year. Still got 2 months to go. And because I travel so much, listen, I'm in airports. I'm in different places. And here's what I've noticed. People's hearts are failing them for fear. People are sizing each other up when they're getting on airplanes, wondering who's the next this and the next. Can I tell you something? Don't let anything or anyone steal your peace, because peace is your portion. I'm telling you right now, bind up the brokenhearted. Open the blind eyes. Can I tell you something? We're in a nation that is blinded. They see, but they never perceive the truth. And I'm telling you right now that the Lord is coming with a whole new perception. It's time to see him as he is, not just as I want him to be. You know how Jesus always came to his disciples? When he came walking out on the water in the storm. You know how he came? When he got on the boat, when they went to the other side. He came as he really was, as he fully was. And I'm here to tell you right now that Jesus is coming into Cornerstone Church with his fullness, the fullness of all that he is. Let me ask you a question. What about the fullness? What about the fullness? I don't want to live my Christian life like my wife drives her vehicle. The little yellow light on. 0 miles till empty. I want to live fully full. Why? Because he said I could. And I'm telling you right now, the fullness of all that he is, the fullness of God is dropping in this place like never before. He wants you fully full so you can bind up the brokenhearted, give sight to the blind. Thirdly, to open up the prison doors. Here's what I've discovered. It's probably my favorite message of all times. I've discovered this about Jesus. He didn't come to redecorate my jail cell. Jesus did not come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people live. He did not come to redecorate my jail cell. I know a lot of people, they get born again, but they stay in their same circumstance and situation. They might put some roses by their bunk, some curtains over the bars, but they're still imprisoned. He didn't just come to open my prison doors. He came to break me out. And I believe that this is a season of breaking out. The Lord is about to break you out into something new, into something great like never before. The thing that stops people from doing what God wants them to do is a thing called fear. It's a trick of the enemy. If you want to know the two things that the enemy uses the most in this season, it's discouragement and disappointment. Ask David, not me. King David, the psalmist, he said these words, "My heart would have failed me for fear had I not believed that I would see the goodness of God in the land of the living." The Bible says these words, that David encouraged himself in the Lord. I love that scripture. Why? Because it tells me that he wasn't unlike me, that sometimes I get discouraged. You know what Goliath did the most? Goliath's biggest weapon wasn't his size. But Goliath's words paralyzed the people of God. They were the people of God. He sent them out to take down the Philistines. And they're in a camp, and they get a giant named Goliath saying, "You're nothing but a dog. You're weak. You're broken. I'm going to come, and I'm going to enslave you. I'm going to destroy you. You're nothing. You're nobodies." And guess what happened? They heard it every day, and they believed it. They forgot who they were. And David comes out to bring them some lunch, and he hears this Goliath telling him they're nothing and they're nobody and they can't and they won't. And he says, "Is there not a cause? Does this guy even know who he's talking about?" He's talking about the children of God, the people of God like this. So he goes to King Saul. You know the story. Paraphrasing it, he says, "I'll take him out." His brothers looked at him and said, "You're just a ruddy little boy. What are you going to do?" And what did he do? He started rehearsing his victories. He said, "Well, one time there was a lion, and then there was a bear. So this giant isn't nothing for me." They tried to put on Saul's armor, but guess what? It was too big. God has armor that fits you perfectly. He has an anointing that fits you perfectly. See these shoes this morning? I packed them by accident. They're actually my son's shoes. They're too big for me. Honestly, they're a size too big for me. These are 12 and a halves. On a good day, I'm 11 and a half. I'm more like an 11. I mean, you're looking at this. This is a 10. Listen, I am more than eye candy. You hear me? I'm handsome, I am humble, and I am proud of it. What am I doing? I'm prophesying. Speaking those things that are not as though they were. These are my son's shoes. I packed them by accident. I remember a day when he would try to walk in my shoes. And he would trip. And he couldn't fill them out, and he'd fall down. Still picture it, the little diaper on. But now I'm walking in his. Can I tell you something? There is a baton being passed to the next generation that will not be discouraged, that will not be disappointed, but will be filled with hope and the power of the Holy Spirit. And we will walk in their shoes. And I'm telling you right now, they will do greater exploits and greater things than we could ever do. Because they know something we don't know. They know who they are. They're looking for something real, not religious. They're looking for something worth living for and, when necessary, worth dying for. Come on, I'm telling you right now. Psalm 118 says these words. "The Lord is on my side. Who will I fear? The Lord God is with me. Of whom will I be afraid?" Lord asked me a question not too long ago, a few weeks ago. He said, "Son, what if what you're afraid of is actually more afraid of you?" I think in the body, we spend a lot of time shadow boxing. I first got saved, man. I don't know where he found you, what he did for you, but I was a mess. I was bona fide crazy, schizophrenic, alcoholic, perverted, a mess. Tried committing suicide 10 times. 10th time I was successful. On January 17, 1997, he reached down in my mess. I was on life support. My mom prayed a prayer, God make my son a miracle. I named him David because I always believed he'd be my shepherd boy. And he reached down in my mess and he picked me up. And I died crazy, but I woke up in my sound mind. And that was the power of God. That's how I started on this journey. And I was just thankful to be alive. And I got set free and God started filling me and moving in me and around me. And I loved it. And then he asked me a question. Do you want to see a demon? I said, no, God, I got rid of a bunch of those. I don't want to see one. And he showed me anyway. Just like God, isn't it? And he showed me this little cockroach-looking thing behind a screen that tried to make itself look really big. And he said, son, I don't want you to shadow box. I want you to squash the bug. And some of you right now, I'm telling you right now, in this place, the season of shadow boxing is over. That you are about to step on. Listen, I'm telling you, he has anointed your feet to step on the heads of demons and scorpions. And it won't harm you. It can't come against you because you are the children of God. Come on, what's the whole purpose of terrorism? To terrorize you. To terrorize the earth. Can I tell you something? I believe your assignment is to terrorize hell. When there's an anointing dropping in this room to terrorize hell, to terrorize the enemy like never before. Come on. What would you do today if you weren't afraid? I'll be done in a couple minutes. Just look at me for a few moments. Some of you right now, you need to realize that what you're afraid of is more afraid of you. Almost 20 years ago when he saved me, I just shared a piece of the story. He called me to preach. There was a huge problem with that. I had three major fears. I had a fear of rejection. How many know that's a powerful fear? I couldn't look anybody in the eyes because I had no self-esteem. And if you looked at me, I assumed you were rejecting me. Just where I was. I had a fear of public speaking because I had a lisp, a stammer, and a stutter. To make it worse, when I was 12 years old playing baseball, I went for a foul ball and my teeth got stuck in the catcher's forehead. 42 stitches in my tongue. You can imagine how much more that affected my speech. I had a fear of man. I was just happy cleaning toilets in the church. A pastor took me on a trip to northern Minnesota, northern Manitoba, Canada. We were doing meetings in this Native Cree reserve. About an hour before a meeting one night, he said, you're preaching tonight. And I said, didn't you get the memo? I can't preach. I can't talk. He said, I heard God. You're going to preach tonight. And I found a scripture and I stood up to preach and I failed miserably. For 7 minutes, I mumbled and stuttered and drew circles on the carpet with my toes, tears streaming down my face. After 7 minutes, I said, in the name of Jesus, amen. I handed it back to my pastor and he fixed it. Went back to the room that night and we were talking and I'm sure he was thinking what I was thinking and maybe I was never called to preach. The next day, he made me do it again. couple minutes before the meeting. He said, "You're going to do it again." I said, "But what if I fail?" He said, "Then you're going to do it again. Because I heard God. And failure is never final where there's a father. You're going to do it again." Something happened. I opened my mouth and a roar came out of me. And the stutter left and a sound came. Can I tell you something? If I were God, I would have picked somebody different. But sometimes your biggest fear becomes your greatest success. And I'm just telling you right now that every one of you is called by God and chosen. Here's what I found is rejection is really a compliment in disguise. Because if it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. The Bible says the one the builders rejected, yet called by God and chosen. So when you're rejected by men, it's probably because you're called by God. I'm telling you right now, it's time for the church to start facing her fears. I said it to the dream team last night. I'll say it to you. I landed in Connecticut yesterday, and this is what I heard the Lord say. She don't know she's beautiful. Connecticut doesn't know how beautiful she is. New England doesn't know how beautiful she is. The church of New England doesn't know how beautiful and how powerful she is, but I'm about to show her. I'm about to release an identity upgrade and a prophetic upgrade because I'm calling her up into her rightful place. I'm calling her up as the called out ones, the chosen ones. Listen, God isn't shrugging things off. He's calling us higher. Can I tell you something? He didn't focus on what was wrong in me. He focused on what was missing in me. Righteousness, peace, joy, confidence, love. And he began to fill me with those things that were missing. And some of you right now, you are a work in process. You are a work in progress. And God is about to put those things that are missing on the inside of you. And don't you fear for a moment that somehow God is going to look past you. He's looking right at you. And he is calling you up into who you are to show forth his image like never before. I know we are living in chaotic, unusual times. But the way I read my Bible from Genesis 1 to the end of Revelation is that God specializes in bringing order to chaos. That God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things in unusual times. He finds a Daniel who was made a eunuch. Are you hearing me? They took his manhood away. They took his identity away. But he knew who he was. And the one thing they couldn't take away was the word of the Lord in his life that restored the image of God and the imagination of a generation. Where are the Daniels of our day? When a nation was about to be annihilated, he found an orphan girl named Esther who could have found all of her insecurities and used them as excuses. But she made up her mind that if I perish, then I perish. For I was born for such a time as this. And he found a Peter. He didn't probably have the best vocabulary and didn't always have the right attitude. When it came down to moments that mattered, he got the answer right. I say, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. Changes his name from Simon Bar-Jonah to Peter. And he says, upon this rock, I'll build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And a few chapters later, Peter misses it miserably. They said, he's been with him. He said, I don't know the man. And he denies Jesus three times. You know the story. Jesus comes and he restores him. says, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Many times he failed, he gets restored. And I think finally Peter gets it. Jesus didn't choose me for my fishing ability. He didn't choose me for how great I could preach. He didn't choose me because my sword could cut the ear off of a soldier. All he really wanted me for was for me to love him. Can I tell you something? If you'll get that right, you'll get everything else right. The only thing Jesus wants from me is for me to love him. And I wonder what it would look like if we were a church that simply falls in love with Jesus all over again and falls in love with each other all over again. I wonder what would happen if we became who he called us to be and said we would be a city set on a hill whose light cannot be hidden. I've got good news for you. While there is chaos in the earth, Jesus is on the throne. While people are waging war and all of those things, God is moving powerfully. I'll end with these stories. I'm honored to be a part of a movement called Europe Shall Be Saved. It was birthed out of a dream of Reinhard Bonnke and Daniel Colunde, picked up by my friend Jean-Luc Traxel in Switzerland. He called 30 of us together. And the reason I said yes was because of a moment in God at Cornerstone Church last November. On a Friday night, right before the meeting, the terrorist attack happened in Paris. We came together and I watched this amazing pastor of yours stand up with tears in his eyes, weeping, crying out for a move of God, crying out for souls to be saved and God to intervene. And I've gone to Europe a lot, but I've never felt the passion and the grip like I felt that day when he prayed. And doors began to open. I got invited to be a part of this group. I've got good news for you. In Paris, right down the road from that place, there was a Russian Orthodox church in Paris that connected with a charismatic Pentecostal preacher and said, we want to open our building for healing rooms. And the churches began to work together, and priests in the Catholic Church started getting spirit-filled and started seeing conversions take place all around. We've come together. No exaggeration. If anything, I may be minimizing it some. But here's what's happened. From May of 2016 to right now in October 2016, out of those groups of 30 that have reached more people than that. Now listen, God's not in numbers, he's in the names, but we've seen over 100,000 people give their lives to the Lord all over Europe just in the last 5 months. I don't know about you, but I think that's pretty miraculous. I think it's pretty marvelous. I think it's pretty powerful. I'm saying that to tell you because it's time for the American church to arise. I wonder what would happen if we started contending for Connecticut to be saved, New England to be saved, for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit to transpire and to be poured out like never before. Come on, I believe hope is rising in this nation. In the midst of uncertainty, I'm confident of one thing. I am persuaded by this one thing, that my circumstances and the circumstances of America do not change who God is. But everything will change around God. And I'm just telling you right now that this is a season to let fear go. Some of you need to look fear in the face. Some of you need a good dose of Joyce Meyer preaching that if you're afraid to do something God's called you to, then do it afraid. Come on, right now. The Lord is calling us out of the shadows. He's calling us out of the hidden places. Because the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach good news. I will absolutely, positively close with this. I believe right now that the Lord is about to move mountains. He's about to pour out his Spirit on all flesh. Our children are about to prophesy. We're about to see his kingdom come. It's a season of revealing. Daniel chapter 2, verse 19. Then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. So Daniel blessed the God of heaven, and Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for the wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the seasons." I want you to know that God is changing times and seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. Aren't you glad? He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and secret things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. Come on, right now. The Lord has anointed you for times and seasons. He's anointed you for the secret things. He's calling you out because times and seasons are changing. Ma'am, sir, brother, sister, my friends, hear me. You were born for such a time as this. While the hearts of men fail them for fear, we need to be encouraged in the goodness of God. I feel his goodness in the room today. When I feel the outpouring of the Holy Spirit coming, I will tell you this, that I have a friend in Germany pastoring a great church. There's a crisis in Germany right now from the Syrian refugees just walking across Europe. They don't know what to do with them. Many people are afraid of them. Are they terrorists? Are they ISIS? All of these different things. But my friend realized this isn't opposition. This is opportunity. And on average, they're winning 15 to 20 former ISIS fighters and Syrian refugees to the Lord. Muslims are being converted at a massive rate. Could it be that it could happen here in America? Come on, could it be that one of our greatest problems could become one of our greatest promises? Could it be that what we see as an enemy, God is seeing as future sons and daughters? I'm not saying don't be wise. I'm not saying don't protect our borders. But what I am saying is this. We better get the heart of God for the moment and the time that we're living in. I have a friend. I was just in Jordan on the Syrian border, outside of my friend's doorstep of his apartment. The day I arrived, they wiped out 17 ISIS fighters. They killed him and arrested 13 others. And I will tell you, when I arrived, I never felt so much peace in my life. 7 miles, 5 miles from the Syrian border, I was in perfect peace. And I'm telling you right now, I realize that God is bigger than anything. He's bigger than anyone. And the safest place to be is in the will of God. My friend is walking and he'll knock on the door of a house. He'll say, "Hey, my name is Daniel." And they'll say, "I know who you are. The man in white came to me last night and told me you were coming and you would tell me who he is." It's happened 27 times in the last year. Because God's on the throne. And I'm here to tell you right now that the Spirit of the Lord is upon you. He has anointed you to preach good news. Some of you right now, you're being anointed like that. You're going to shake somebody's hand and tell them who you are, and they're going to say, "I know who you are. The man in white told me who you were, and he said you would tell me who he is." It's a season of a setup. Come on, I feel the setup of God in the room today. This is not what I preached in first service. But I believe it's rhema. I believe it's revelation for you right now in this moment. The Lord is on our side. What can man do to us? I'm a little over on time, but you only have to deal with me once a year, so you're fine. And so am I. That's a joke. The roast is almost ready. I can tell you right now, that's the phone call. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I thank you right now for every man, every woman, within the sound of my voice. Lord, I thank you that, Lord, there's not just an impartation in the room today, but, Lord, you're making a deep deposit. Lord, there is an identity upgrade, and there is a prophetic upgrade on the inside that you are calling us up into. Lord, you've not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. And, Lord, I just believe right now as we walk in love, as we walk in righteousness, peace, and joy, as we realize the full-grown Jesus is on the inside of us, that he's put his hand in our hands, his feet in our feet. And Lord, he has anointed us. The Spirit of the Lord is upon us. He has anointed us to preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to set the captive free, to restore sight to the blind, to declare the good and acceptable year of the Lord. Lord, you're in this room today. Lord, over the last few minutes, Lord, I believe that you've been healing hope. You've been building confidence and courage. That you're restoring things. You're giving us new perspective. Lord, I release that anointing of faith, hope, and love over your people this morning. Every eye closed, every head bowed in the room. If you're in this room today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or maybe you once knew him and you're away from God this morning, I want you to know that Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart and he will pursue you. He will not relent until he has you because he loves you. Romans says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's bad news. It means we all deserve to die and go to hell. But the good news is this: while we were yet sinners, Christ came and he died for us. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that who would ever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." Verse 17, "For the Son of Man did not come to condemn the world, but to save it." We're all sinners. We're all in need of a Savior. Jesus went to the cross and gave his life. He paid a debt that he didn't owe. He paid the price we could never pay. In the book of Acts, it says, "Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. For there is no other name under heaven or in earth by which a man can be saved but the name of Jesus." And something happens when you call out his name. There's something that happens when you get the revelation of who he is, like Peter did. Paul said that if you believe in your heart that Jesus is the Son of God and God raised him from the dead, then you're children of God. If you're away from God, you don't know him as your personal Lord and Savior today. Maybe your heart has failed you for fear because you don't know him. And today you came in here looking for hope. He wants to give you hope, but even greater, he wants to give you himself. He's the Prince of Peace. He is hope eternal. If you're in the room today and you don't know Jesus, or you're away from God this morning and you need to get right with him, I don't want to embarrass you. I just want to pray for you. If you want me to include you in that prayer, I want you to do something very bold. I just want you to lift your hand. You put it right back down. I see your hand back there. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand, ma'am. I see your hand, ma'am. I see your hand, sir. I see your hand, ma'am. All across the room. I see your hand in the back. Thank you, ma'am. Come on. I see the hands all around this room. I see your hands in the back. Thank you. Come on, all across the room today. It's why Cornerstone exists, to bring life. Come on, he didn't come to redecorate your jail cell. He came to break you out. Jesus took all of it a step further. He said, "If you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven." So if you raised your hand, or you should have, I'm going to ask you to do something even bolder. I'm going to ask you to get out of your seat and come to the front where I am. I'm going to keep my word. I'm not going to embarrass you. I just want to pray for you. It makes it easier to do this. "Pastor Dave, can I do this in my seat?" Absolutely. But there's something that happens when I come. There's something that happens when I move. Come on, right now. If you raised your hand, or you should have, I just want you to come and stand right here. There are about 5, 6, 7 hands that went up around the room. A bunch went up in first service as well. Lord, right now, Lord, I thank you that, Lord, I can't preach anybody in. Lord, I can't lead anybody to you unless the Holy Spirit draws them. So, Holy Spirit, I thank you for your word in this room. We're going to begin to pray together here in a second. If you're sitting in the room, before I give this back to Pastor Eric right now, if you be honest and you say, "David, my heart has been failing me for fear. My heart's been failing me for fear. I feel paralyzed by fear. Maybe disappointment and discouragement. The enemy's been speaking it over you. Maybe you feel depressed. Maybe all of these things happening on. Maybe you filled your life with, you've been feeding on these bad reports from the news media. All of those things. You need God to break that fear and discouragement and disappointment off of you. I want you to stand to your feet. I'm going to break it off of you real quick as Pastor Eric's getting ready to come. If I'm talking to you, you're filled with discouragement, disappointment, or fear, I just want you to stand. I want you to lift your hands towards heaven right now. If you're around somebody standing right now, I just want you to stretch your hand towards them. If you're right next to them, just lay your hands on them. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, but I just thank you right now, God, that you are good. In every season, God, you are good. And your goodness and your faithfulness have never been in question. And your throne has never been in jeopardy. Jesus, you are sitting on the throne of our lives, just like you're sitting on the throne of America today. And Lord, I ask that, God, you would take your rightful place. Lord, I break off discouragement. I break off despair. I break off disappointment. And I speak life, and life more abundantly right now to every believer in this room. You've not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Holy Spirit, right now, drop in this room. Those of you that have come, your hands are being lifted, giving everything to Him. It means I surrender. But on Friday, when I finally go home, tomorrow I'll go to Chicago and then on to South Dakota. Friday, when I get home, I'll tell you what'll happen. My 8-year-old will not want to stay in the car. He'll want to meet me in the airport. And as soon as he sees me come out of security, he will run at me with his arms lifted and he will jump in my arms. That's how you're coming to God today. Because He's a good Father. So Lord, I just thank you right now for everyone that's come. It's the greatest miracle you'll ever see, by the way. I've seen the dead raised twice. I've seen the blind see, the deaf hear. But there's no miracle like watching somebody give their life to Jesus. I want everybody in the room to pray this with me as I get ready to give this back to Pastor Eric. Say, Lord Jesus Christ, I give you everything. I give you my past. I give you my present. And I give you my future. I believe that you're the Son of God. And you died on the cross for my sins. And God raised you from the dead. Jesus, I admit I'm a sinner. I've broken your law and your heart. But today I confess you're my perfect Savior. Thank you for dying for me so I can live for you. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Be my very best friend. And from this moment on, I will do my best to live for you the rest of the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Pastor Eric's going to take the service. I'm going to pray for those that have come.
Amen. Let's just thank God right now for the work that He's doing together in His room. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And as we continue to minister, we're going to conclude here in a few moments. Before we do that, I know many of you prepared to give this morning with your tithes and your offerings. So we want to give you an opportunity to do that in a few moments. So go ahead and get ready to give for that at this time. Also, maybe some of you would like to be able to sow into what David Wagner is doing. If you have a special offering beyond what your normal tithe and offering is, feel free to do such as that as well. And so let's just go ahead and pray for that right now. Father, we want to thank you so much for what you're doing right here in the midst of us right now. We just ask you, bless these tithes and these offerings, which is part of our worship. We thank you for what you're doing in this room right now. We thank you for Pastor Dave. Lord, we ask you to bless him and continue to expand your grace in his life. In Jesus' name. Okay, let's just go ahead and as you prepare to give, and a few moments, give people one more chance to get ready. And then also want to let folks know, I know we're going to continue to dismiss the service. However, we're going to allow the front space to be open for prayer. So if you need prayer, we'd love to be able to pray with you. And we want to invite you to want to come to Grove Track. Step 4 will be taking place at my right-hand side. In your bulletin is a connection card. It's a little blue card. If you gave your life to Christ today or have a prayer concern, this is the way we connect. We encourage you to fill that out and put it in one of the brown boxes as you leave today or give it to one of the ushers. Okay, everybody? So that's what's happening today. Grove Track, Step 4. Right hand side. I encourage you to come. We have lunch ready for you and child care. So that's what's happening. Once you've given, let's go ahead and stand as we conclude this segment of the service, but we're going to leave it open for prayer. front open for prayer. God bless you.